Shucks, Donald. Yeah. I've always wanted to do that. Honestly, only in America. I was walking here this morning and I saw a sign, Segways for Hire. Wow, you know, amazing. So I had to do it. I thought this could be the worst decision in my life to come out on a Segway. I also yesterday saw Santa Claus, this is true, so driving a motorcycle, driving a Harley Davidson motorcycle or something around. You know, we Irish drink because we don't have that kind of stuff going on, you know. I just saw Santa Claus driving on a motorcycle. What are you drinking? Give me some of that. You know, it's just like, this is one surreal journey for me. Segways and Santa Claus. That had no point other than I wanted to drive a Segway. Have you noticed, by the way, that Rob and Shane don't use notes? You know why? I'm going to tell you the secret. They're going to hate me for this. I'm behind there telling them what to say. You know, honestly. Everything. Never had an original thought in their lives. Never, honestly. Shane, the message is the medium. The message is the medium. You know. Rob, it's subversion. Subversion to subvert. Honestly. Be easier to train monkeys. Oh, sorry. Oh. Oh, yeah. Which is get off the stage. I know. You all know the only reason why I'm here is because Rob phones me and says, Pete, you know, there's 10 people signed up for this conference, mate. He says, honestly, he says, it's a nightmare. He says, we need your star power. I'm going like, Rob, you know, I don't know if you can afford me. And I said, you're going to need a bigger venue. You're going to have to get that auditorium. He says, listen, Pete, just save me this once, mate. I'm like, you know, Rob, you of all people should know, it's Jesus wants to save Christians, not me, you know. But I help him out, I do that. So I'm going to use notes, maybe. Some things I should say, by the way, some people think, I talk so as only a few people can understand me, you know? And they go, only a few people can get what you're saying because of the accent, because of the words, the philosophy. And that really annoys me because I'm trying to speak in such a way that nobody understands what I'm saying. And so it's disappointing. So really your job here is to try to take notes. And my job is to make it impossible for you to do that, okay? My job is complete if you're trying to take notes and have no ability, no notion of what to say, you know? The other thing I should say is that the secret of my heart, the reason why I'm here, is not because I have some great message to share. I'm standing up here because my mum didn't tell me she loved me enough when I was a child, or because I wanted to be a rock star and no one would listen to me sing. Whatever it is, I have lots of insidious reasons for standing up here, and I pretend it's because I've got something great to say, when it's probably only my insecurities that put me on a stage. I just want to be loved, you know? That's the segue thing. I'm just going, now the girls will like me, you know? And so the secret of many speakers' hearts, you know, is my job is all I want is lots of little Pete Rollins is running around the world. It's like spiritual intercourse. I want to, have lots of people seeing the world like I see the world, thinking like I think. You know, like in the Matrix where the virus reproduces itself so that everything basically is a reflection of itself. That's what I want, you know? And that's why I stand here. And your job is to resist that. Okay, so I'm trying, because Nietzsche once said, all communication is consumption, i.e. when a lion eats a lamb, the lamb becomes part of the lion's DNA, the lion's energy and structure. So what I'm doing is I'm trying to consume your thought, I'm trying to make it look like mine, okay? So you have to resist, and if you agree with me that you should disagree with me, well, then you agree with me, and I'm already winning. And one final proviso, if that's the right word, is that, I was in a debate about last year, and after I did my bit, it was with a bishop, and the bishop got up and said, I agree with much of what Pete says, but not everything. You know, sometimes he goes too far. And I thought, that's exactly how I feel. I like most of what I say, but sometimes I can't agree with it all. Sometimes I just go too far. You know, it's like, yeah. So I just went, yeah, absolutely. So if I disagree with myself, of course, you please disagree with me. Please fight with what I'm doing and what I'm about. So for the next just, 40 minutes or so, or, I know you've been very patient and all, I'm going to try and talk a little bit about what am I going to talk about? Yeah, Revelation. You know, all of this kind of neo-fundamentalist kind of, Jesus is a wrestler type of stuff, right? Jesus is a cage fighter thing, right? What's the problem with that? They'll say by people like me, he's just like a cappuccino drinking, polo neck wearing kind of like guy. The only sin is using the wrong dessert spoon over dinner, right? We're the real tough, let's be militant. I go, my response is? It's not, you're not too violent. You're not violent enough. Your violence is like the man who beats up his wife. It's an impotent violence. It's not a violence that, it's a violence against flesh and blood. The violence of Christianity is a violence against principalities and powers. This is a real, the Christianity is fundamentally violent in the way that, look at Mother Teresa. Her violence, her pacifism was violent. Why? Because it completely ruptured the caste system that she was working in. The whole system of power that placed people in different castes. She came in and she looked after everybody equally and she ruptured the system. You look at Gandhi, who in his pacifism ruptured the system of colonialism. You look at Martin Luther King, in his pacifism, he ruptured and traumatized and broke the system of racism that was not so much what you saw, it was the lens through which you saw everything. Right? That's what a system is. A system or an ideology is not that which you see, it's that which you see through. And each of these people were truly doing something powerful. So all of this posturing, which ends up just being violent against people and violent against individuals, but not challenging systems of injustice. It's just not violent enough. Right, so today, Revelation. We've got this really crazy idea in the church, and I don't know how we did it, that we think Revelation is about revealing. That's crazy, isn't it? Who would have ever thought that? Revelation's about revealing. That's mad, right? Actually, I think it is. We think that revelation is, and I mentioned it yesterday, I think, God whispering in the ear, that God tells us something. So that in the same way that the theologian talks about God, like a biologist talks about biological systems, or a cosmologist talks about star systems. And the question often I see in this kind of a whole new atheist thing is Christianity true? And so some people say, yes, Christianity's true. Some people say, no, Christianity's not true. But that's not the question. The question is not, is Christianity true? The question is, what does Christianity mean when it claims to be true? Right? The question is not, is Christianity true? The question we should ask is, what does Christianity claim when it claims to be true? Because if we don't ask that question, we just assume that the truth of Christianity is the same as the truth of biology, the same as the truth of psychology or physics. We assume something that actually I think we need to question. That revelation doesn't mean that we have some information about God, like a biologist has information about a biological system. Something else is going on, and I want to expose this, and then I want to talk about how it influences how we preach and how we do church. Now, the desire to speak God, to actually know what God's like, is a very ancient thing. We all know who the first woman in the Bible was. The first woman. Who was the first woman? No. You're terrible. The first woman was Lilith. Eve was the second woman, right? In at least in Jewish mythology, right? The myth goes like this. Some rabbis were sitting around, this is true, rabbis were sitting around, and they noticed that it said, on the sixth day, God made male and female, right? And then they noticed a wee bit later on that it said, once Adam was bored, had named all the animals, and had got lonely, God created Eve. And so the rabbis thought, who is this woman who was created on the sixth day? She must have been a nightmare. Right? She must have been like some untamable woman, and Adam and God just went, let's never mention her again, okay? Let's just sweep her under the carpet. Let's try and create someone a little easier to handle, okay, this time, okay? She was a wild one, okay? And so we only have this thing of this woman who was created on the sixth day. So in Jewish mythology, they say, well, the first woman was Lilith. And Lilith and Adam lived together, but Adam feared her. He feared her sexuality, and he wanted to rule over her as a lord rather than live with her as a lover. And one night he says to her, "I want to lie on top of you." And she said, "No, we lie side by side, for we are equal under the eyes of God." Adam doesn't like this, you know, typical guy, you know, a bit nervous about, you know. And so problems break out. So it's really Adam causes a whole pile of problems, jip or whatever. And then Lilith goes, "I've got to escape." So what she does is she devises a plan. And she finds God walking in the cool of the garden. Well, that might be for me. You know, I told them I wasn't here. If it's the British government, I'm not here. You never saw me. You don't know who I am. Where was I? Yes. Have I started yet? Yeah, I'm Lilith. She finds God walking in the cool of the day. She sits down and she goes, "Oh, you know," they chat, you know, God's in a good mood. And Lilith says, "Tell me your name, your secret name, the name that you don't tell anyone else, the name you keep locked within you. And so God's in a good mood, you know, so God whispers the name into Lilith's ear. And the story goes that Lilith shouts the name aloud, grows massive wings from her back, and flies out of Eden, never to return. Or to return one more time in a different guise to try and free Eve. Who could that be? So this is so that's the story of Lilith. Now, what is that about? Well, the story arises because of an ancient belief that gods have names. And if you know the name of God, if you can name God, you can have power, divine power. Okay? You see it in Egyptian mythology as well, where Isis tricks the sun god Ra into revealing a name. Ra walks from one side of the world to the other every night, you know, like the sun, sunrise, sunset. But he's old, so halfway along, he always stops for a nap. And because he's old, he sometimes dribbles, saliva dribbles from his mouth. And so what happens is Isis collects some of the mud that's made from the saliva and the dirt. She forms a snake, and she can't breathe life into the snake because only Ra can bring life. But the next day, Ra's going across on his daily journey, and he notices the snake, and he speaks it into life. Cobra! But because he didn't create it, he can't control it, it bites him. And he falls into a fever, and basically Isis gets the name in exchange for healing. She becomes the most powerful goddess in Egyptian mythology. Now, this all helps us understand, you know, Exodus 3, whenever we find Moses in the desert walking along, and he sees this burning bush, and he says, you know, here's the unconditional call, you know, his name, Moses. And he gives the unconditional response, "Here am I," that response which you see throughout the Bible. And then God reveals who God is. "I am the God of your forefathers, you know, this is who I am. I have called you to free your people." So then Moses' unconditional response begins to waver, and he says, not "who are you to ask me to do this?" He doesn't want to do that. But he says, "Who am I to do such a task?" And God says, "I shall be with you." And then what does Moses do? Moses says, well, what's your name? If the people ask me, you know, who will I say sent me? Now, of course, he already knows it's God he's talking to. He already knows it's God who's in front of him. What's he trying to find out? Well, schooled in Egyptian mythology, schooled in that understanding that gods have names, a lot of people say, well, he's trying to find a name. What is the name of God? Because I'm a stuttering old man. If I had that name, you know, get that name, you know, I'll get it. Now, God, and I'll maybe come back if I have time to God's response, because it's fascinating. But this idea of name, and you see it in the Kabbalah tradition as well. You've got the monogrammata, the one-letter name of God, the diagrammata, the two-letter name, the tetragrammaton, the four, the octagrammaton, the eight, the decagrammaton. You've got the 12, the 14, the 33, the 42, the 216-letter name of God, and the big one, which is like 300,000 and something, which is all the letters of the Torah put together and said in one breath, which is hard even for me, and I talk fast. This session with the name. If you can name God, you have this power. And then we see it continued on through tradition, not only in mythology, but in theology. God's no longer put into one word. God's put into systematic theology. Let's speak God. And it doesn't give us any magical powers anymore, but it gives us a deep insight into the essence of the world, theology, the queen of sciences. And you see it in philosophy with Descartes and all that. So basically what I'm trying to say is that this desire to name God and to speak God, you can see throughout history. It's not a new thing. But is this something that God plays along with? Or because there's all that stuff in the Bible, the prohibition of naming. You know, my name is above every name. What does that mean? Well, you take someone like Anselm, the mystic. Anselm says, well, hold on a second. He says, let's imagine how things exist. This is a bit of philosophy. He says, something can exist in the mind, but not in reality. Okay, that's a rubbish way of existing. Imagine existing just as an idea. Right? That's rubbish. A million pounds in your head is just ridiculous. So that's a rubbish way of existing. Santa Claus, although I did see him yesterday, but technically, it doesn't exist. Sorry to break it to you. He exists in the mind, but not in reality. And then Anselm says, well, then we can imagine something that exists in the mind and in reality. So I can imagine this passport, but I've also got it. It exists both in my mind, I've got a representation of it. That's a nice picture. And also, it exists in reality. And Anselm kind of is saying that, well, you know, for a lot of people, that's what God's like. God exists as an idea, but doesn't exist in reality, okay? So there's the people who believe that. And then it's almost like Christians believe that whenever Jesus shows up, or whatever, you know, God exists in reality and exists in our mind. We can have an idea of God. It's like the lights have been turned on. Bam, the lights have been turned on. God is no longer anonymous. God is present. So it's almost like going into a bar and you know you're looking around and it's very dark. You know your friend's there. You can't quite see their face. And a lot of Christians would say that's like creation. It's like anonymously, God is kind of seen anonymously through creation. And then with revelation, the lights turned on. There we see the face of God. We see God. We see our friend. But Anselm says no. He says, there's a third level of existence. He says, it's possible for something to exist in reality, but be so majestic that it can't exist in your mind. And so what the words for this is that God is not anonymous. Anonymity is when you don't know something because there's a lack of information. This is hypernimity. What's hypernimity? Hypernimity is whenever you don't know something because there is an excess, a surplus, you're overflowing. It's like you're a ship sunken in the very depths of the ocean. And while the water contains the ship and the ship contains the water contains the entire ship and the ship contains only a fragment of the water. That's what Anselm says about God. You know, you look at the sun, you go blind. God is not unknown because there is a lack. God cannot be grasped because there is such an excess. God is traumatic. God is a trauma. What is a trauma? A trauma is an event that happens which you cannot program into the matrix of your current understanding. So it's an event that you cannot conceptualize. Something so crazy that you don't have words to describe it. So take a trauma of something, some really bad abuse. Somebody is in court saying that some really bad abuse took place. If their testimony is very clear, it's got the very exact times and very exact dates, what's that evidence of? They're lying. Or at least there's more likelihood that they're lying. If someone who has had a really crazy experience, bad or really good experience, they can give a really clear account, you've got to go, oh, is that true? But if they get up and actually the testimony doesn't quite fit and the dates and the times and it all just doesn't fit, that's not testimony that they're lying. That's testimony that they're telling the truth, right? That's why I find it so bizarre that Christians think the Bible, you know, that it's divine because, you know, you've got like a lack of conflictual stuff in it, a lack of tensions, a lack of contradictions. No way. It's divine because there are conflicts, because there are tensions, because there are these flat out contradictions. God is warrior. God is peacemaker. God who hears everything. God who is deaf to the cries of the people. God who is unchanging. God who repents. This is not evidence that this product is human. This is evidence that something traumatic happened, that this is divine. That's bizarre to me, you know. I mean, I got this book when I was a young guy, and it was called Encyclopedia of Biblical Problems, right? Or Biblical Difficulties. I think Zondervan brought it out, actually. Zondervan, yeah. Hey, you know who you are. Yeah. And it was a big, big book of all of the tensions and seeming contradiction, all of that, all written, plus the explanation of why they're not really tensions and conflicts and contradictions, right? I was going like, you should never have brought the book out. One, I never knew there were that many, right? I just thought there were a few. I didn't think there was like this amount. And then the explanations are hilarious. You know, the ways of trying to like reconcile this stuff, you know, it's just laughable. I'm going, this is what the theologians say today. Going like, no, of course you're going to have the breakdown of words. when it comes to the incoming of the infinite into the finite. Of course we're going to blow up, we're going to short circuit, we're going to be saturated, we're going to fall down, and we're going to find... I mean, it's not that one author used the term peacemaker and another author used the term warrior. The same authors were doing it. They were knowingly pushing together metaphors that don't fit neatly. And where's the truth of God? In one metaphor or the other? Or is the truth of God in that which creates the metaphors, you know? That's why, Meister Eckhart, I have to breathe, sorry. Okay. If I pass out, just revive me, you know. If you see my face going blue, that's why Meister Eckhart says, you know, the unnameable, the unnameable is not one we remain silent of. The unnameable is omni-nameable. In other words, when you come in, when you're confronted with the trauma of God, you're not so much reduced to silence. You're like a bubbling mess. As poetry is born, preaching is born at its best, prophecy is born at its best. This is where prophecy gets its meat, in the very impossibility of speaking. As soon as you, I cannot speak this. Well, I will. You know, you let me stand here for 5 days. I will stand here for 5 days and talk about how I cannot say a word about the source of our faith. You know, that's why those mystics wrote volumes about how you cannot write. They sing about how you cannot sing. You know, wonderful stuff. Now, because otherwise they say, well, as soon as you name God, what are you doing? You're creating God in your own image. There's a beautiful story about a kid with crayons drawing a picture, you know, 5-year-old kid. Mother comes in, says, what is that you're drawing? Kid goes, drawing a picture of God, right? And mother laughs and says, you know, nobody knows what God looks like. And the kid just smiles, looks up and says, maybe not, but they soon will. Yeah. And yeah, so, and that's kind of sometimes what like theology seems to be, our little broken, fractured words. We think that this is kind of this description of God. And I read that little joke in actually a Christian book, For My Sins. I was reading it, and it was at the beginning, then it said, but this is exactly what Jesus did do. Jesus came and drew a beautiful picture of God. I was going, wow, you know, I don't know. For me, it seems like every time I read Jesus, Jesus tears up my images of who I think God is. God is like, not a, as Viktor Frankl would say, God is not a painter. Jesus isn't a painter. He's an optician. Doesn't paint a picture, but helps fix our eyes so that we are dazzled by the incoming of something wonderful and beyond us. You know, it's like, otherwise, theology becomes like Homer Simpson. You know, the first time Homer Simpson ever prays, he's about to go over a waterfall. He says, I don't know if you exist. I don't know if what they say about you is true. And I don't know if you can hear me now. But Superman, if you exist, please save me. Okay, right? You know, and that's what we kind of do. God becomes, as soon as we start putting words to God, God reflects, just, you know, people's dogs look like their owners, you know? People's gods look like them. God is not the patch of meaning that we put on the wound of our unknowing. God is the wound upon which we put the patches of meaning. This is the God that Jesus seems to reveal. Where is it? How biblical is this? That's the answer. It's a good argument, isn't it? Yeah. You look at the answer that God gave to Moses when he looked for the name. What did he say? Well, it's often translated, I am who I am, but a lot of the Jewish scholars translate it as, I shall be there, howsoever I shall be there. So whenever Moses says, what's your name? This is God saying, you cannot handle my name. My name is above every name. You know what my name is? Presence. You know what my promise is? Neither height nor depth, life nor death, nothing will separate you from my presence. That's what's going on. My presence is my name. That's why whenever Jacob wrestles God, same thing. Jacob knows that he's wrestling God at the end. What does he say? Tell me your name. Tell me your name. That's what Jacob wants to know. Why? I want a blessing. I want your name. And what does God say? God says, why do you want to know my name? Right? And then God answers him. What does God answer him with? By renaming Jacob. God's name names us. That's what you get in baptism, you know. We are brought into the name of God. So, in other words, God's response, God's name is a blessing. That's what God's name is, a presence beyond all finding out. Now, this is what I think is going on in Jesus in the New Testament as well. As you have, the point of Jesus in the incarnation is not that the mystery of God, right, this transcendent mystery, is now revealed and we understand it. Is it not that the mystery is brought near to us? The mystery now lives among us. The mystery is here. Like, it's like the TARDIS example I used yesterday. It's like the not yet is right here. So the mystery is deepened. When Jesus comes in, the mystery doesn't disappear. Actually, the mystery is deepened. Goes so much infinitely deeper. Now the mystery touches us in flesh and blood. And I love that, you know, we are created in the image of God. Oh, so that makes God understandable? No, because I'll tell you what, everybody I know is a mystery, you know. We are a mystery unto ourselves, as Augustine would say. That's why Hegel said, the mystery of the Egyptians are mysteries to the Egyptians as well, right? What does that mean? It means, it was like Freud when he's trying to talk about women, right? He says, you know, women aren't a mystery to us. Women are just a mystery unto themselves. But that's the same with everybody. That was Freud kind of trying to deal with women, as men do. How can I understand women, you know? But it's true of us all. I'm a mystery unto myself. We're all mystery. You know, the more I get to know me, the more I go, my goodness, you know? Let's see if we've got anywhere. Oh, yeah, we've done that. And we've done that. And I won't do that. You definitely don't want to see that. So what is revelation? And if revelation isn't this whispering in the ear, because the problem then, as I talked about yesterday, is that we can hear the message without heeding it. Revelation is something that gives us knowledge, and then we become like a physicist. Doesn't matter whether the physicist had an affair yesterday. It doesn't affect his knowledge of physics. It doesn't affect the knowledge of the biologist that they extorted money. Is that the kind of knowledge that we have as Christians? That, you know, we can know the truth without doing it, without being it? Is that the kind of truth we're talking about whenever John says, those who love know God, those who don't love don't know, those who don't love God don't know? That's not the kind of truth that a biologist has. What kind of truth is that? It's a truth that brings life. Perhaps revelation has three features, right? Epistemological incomprehension, like most of what I say, right? Incomprehension, number one. Experiential bedazzlement, right? Bedazzlement, number two. And existential transformation, number three, right? What does that mean? That means when revelation takes place, incomprehension, whoa, what happened? God is apocalypse. Apocalypse means the incoming of that which you could never predict in advance, the incoming of that which you could never nail down. The thing that you can't put in your diary, falling in love, the death of someone you love, finding out you're pregnant, whatever, something that you couldn't have put in your diary is an apocalypse, right? So whenever God shows up, if you don't get more information, suddenly everything you thought you knew is bam, gone. Second, bedazzlement, it's anxiety producing. Oh, what's happening here? Your world is rocking, an inner volcano is taking place, and you don't know how to experience it. And so bedazzlement is the experience of not knowing how to experience. And finally, transformation. You are no longer the same again. Is that not what we see in Paul on the road to Damascus? He's, you know, Caravaggio paints this picture of him falling off his horse, blinded and transformed. For me, that's revelation. That's revelation, you know? Revelation is that which both reveals and conceals at the same time. That which brings into light and also brings us into ever greater darkness, a wonderful place of transformation and change, where we are substantively reconfigured. That's why I do something like Icon, and this is where I want to kind of connect it with preaching in the last, I've got about 10, 15 minutes. You doing okay? Yeah. With me? Hey, you know, you won't have to listen to me after this. I'll be off in the Segway. That's how I'm going to leave. Just go off. You see me? Like the littlest hobo. Just wave goodbye to Rob and Shane and... Off to the next town with my message, like a traveling preacher on my Segway. That's going to be good. The memoirs are going to be good. So I told you a little bit about fundamentalism that we did the other, you know, at Icon, where the protesters were outside. You walked in, there were the images of Bibles being taken stuff out, putting stuff in. It was a big stage like this. There's 3,000 people. There was 5 of us standing in a row. And there was a soapbox. And at the very beginning, this guy gets up and he says, let us begin by worshiping the way, the truth, and the life. And then he started to sing a worship song. And because it was a festival, most people didn't know that it was Icon, and most people don't know that that's not what we do. So people sang along, and they were singing to this song about truth. And then the words on the screen just began to dissolve. And in their place, it said, I am the truth. right? And then those words dims, and it said, follow me. And we're singing, and it goes, be my friend, big letters. And it says, for I shall crush my enemies beneath my feet, for I am the truth. Right? And suddenly, what happens is weird. Suddenly the worship song starts to feel a bit icky, you know? You're singing this triumphalist song about the Jesus being the truth, and suddenly, oh, I feel a bit weird, you know? So suddenly it becomes, uncanny. Hitchcock was very good at the uncanny. Something that looks completely normal, but you just change something slightly, and it makes you feel a bit weird, right? So that was the first experience, and then I told you about some of the things that went on. And then we finished with a beautiful hymn. Oh, that was lucky. Beautiful hymn by this guy Padraig. Padraig's a good friend of mine. He wrote this beautiful song, and it just ended wonderfully. It's called Maranatha, and it goes, you are my strength, but I am weak. You are my strength, but I am weak. You are my strength, but I am weak. Maranatha, Maranatha, Maranatha. I've given up sometimes when I was tired. I've given up sometimes when I was tired. I've given up sometimes when I was tired. Does it move you? Does it move you? Does it move you? I've effed it up so many times. I've effed it up so many times. I thought I'd better not swear. I effed it up so many times. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. You know? Yeah. And goes, you know, and then he goes, this is all based on Jeremiah, right? Jeremiah chapter 3. It has, you look at the theologian Koch, the German theologian. He says the literal translation is not whoring out, which is what, you know, a lot of translations do, but the slightly stronger word. And then this is all from the Lamentations. I curse the day when I perceive the light. I curse the day when I receive the light. I curse the day when I receive the light. When you deceived me, when you deceived me, when you deceived me. I find my home in Babylon. I find my home in Babylon. I find my home in Babylon. Here in exile, here in exile, here in exile. It's the most stunning song. You have to listen to it. Actually, he sent me it on MP3, so I might, if anybody wants to hear it, I can play it to you. By the way, why are worship songs not like that? It was weird. It's all Jesus is my boyfriend stuff, you know? That's all right, like, but, you know, should worship not reflect? The Lamentations reflect our darkness and our doubts and our fears and our ambiguities as much as they reflect love and joy. You know, it's weird how I watch people say, oh, I embrace doubt and complexity and ambiguity. I embrace all of that. And then you go into church and it doesn't express at all. That beautiful way of ending. And the point is, what did it mean? I have no idea. I don't know. I don't know what was going on with all of those things. The girl who stood up on the soapbox, and the woman must remain silent in church, and the other woman who did the Ian Paisley sermon, and all of this stuff. But you know what? It's like David Lynch film. I don't know what happened, or Donnie Darko. You watched Donnie Darko? What was it about? I have no idea, but I felt a bit teary at the end, you know? That's it, you know? No idea. The sermon in the church, it shouldn't be primarily descriptive. Now, it can't have description. It shouldn't be primarily descriptive. It should be performative. We should be mimicking the idea of Revelation. When you walk into church, you should be bedazzled. Find yourself, everything you believed, throw under the wall in comprehension and walk out substantially trained transformation. That's the site. That's why the church is. We are the insurrectionary power. We are that thing. We are those people who are trying to bring people into that experience of radical reconfiguration. We are the revolution, supposedly. You know, that's why we're here. That's why you're here. We are the insurrectionaries, right? So, that's what parables do. Parables are not there to describe something. Parables are there to perform something. They're there to rupture. That's why these parables, you know, they ruptured the people of the day, and they've become dry to us because we've heard them so many times. So we have to find new ways of saying them and speaking them and doing things with them. The parable cannot be heard without being heeded. It needs to be done and incarnated. Hence Jesus says, those with ears to hear, let them hear. I mean, if you look in there's a problem in psychoanalysis at the moment in a certain period. They go, the problem is somebody comes to analysis, right? And you go, why are you beating people up on the street? Come on, why are you doing it? He goes, well, my dad left when we were young, and my mom was a very distant woman, and, you know, And so in other words, they're giving psychoanalytic interpretation of their behavior. They already have an interpretation when they arrive. What does the analyst do? Well, in the Lacanian school, the analyst gives an anti-psychoanalytic reading. He goes, no, it's because you're in Egypt. Do you know what Egypt means? It's because you're a... Don't take responsibility for your own actions, you know? Don't start blaming it on your parents. And because the point is not giving the right interpretation. The point is to rupture the person and create something so that something happens. So when we did Sins of the Father, this beautiful icon where you walk in and there's a DJ and it said, when I was naked, you didn't clothe me. When I was hungry, you did not visit, you know, did not feed me. When I was in prison, you did not visit me. And this DJ's doing that, and that's the music that's going across in those words. And then it says, this is the judgment of humanity against their God. You know, and that's how it begins. This is the judgment of humanity against their God. When I was hungry, you did not feed me. And then that night, a midnight gathering, a midnight service, we wrote down times when God had sinned against us. And we panned them to the front and we read these prayers unless they were X'd. And then we placed them into a ceremonial fire. And it was the most powerful night. And at the end, we gave everyone a Tamagotchi. You know Tamagotchis? They're like little key rings, you know? And we didn't explain it too much, but the point was, well, maybe the God we're fighting is a God of our creation who now makes demands on us, right? Which is a Tamagotchi. It's a thing you make, and then it demands things from you. But we didn't kind of say that. We just gave the Tamagotchis out, and we did reflections. Like, you know, that's what, you know, there's a reason why the first name, the name that was given to the people of God was Israel. Like, the founding name tells you something. What's the name that was given to the people's, God's people? To fight, to wrestle, to fight God and overcome. That's what, you know, you're fighters. I want you to argue with me. That's why God loves the Irish. You know, we love a fight, you know? As a God's chosen people. And one said, your preaching should be a type of discourse, a dis-dash course, a discourse that sends you off course, right? Not a theology, but a theopoetics. A theopoetics being you painting a description that seduces people, that transforms people, that changes people. And you know, you look at Jesus. You know, you look at the Lord's Prayer. People say, "Oh, so you can't say anything about Jesus. You can't say anything about God. You can't say that God's a Father." Well, yes and no. What does Jesus say? "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." What does that mean? It means God's a Father, right? Second line, but not like your Father. God's hallowed. Hallowed meaning holy. Holy meaning set apart. Holy meaning not like your thinking. In other words, God is a Father, but not like your earthly Father. No. Because a 21st century Irish guy has a different understanding of fatherhood to a 3rd century Spanish mystic, to a 1st century German peasant, right? So, in other words, you name God as Father, and yet you immediately say, "Huh, but like, not as I understand it. God's so much more amazing and wonderful." Hence, we didn't. That was the second icon we ever did. We had these images that of God, and like these images of, and so we took the words and we wrote down why these reminded us of God in this bar, and we did all of that. And then at a certain point, we opened the doors up, and outside it was raining. And there was an oil drum, flaming oil drum, and we asked people to take these images that reminded them of God, and that, you know, Father, Mother, landscape, and what we've been sharing with each other, go out and to put them in the oil drum. And then there was somebody out there with an umbrella and praying, you know, over his, you know, well, no matter how wonderful our images of you are, they are but ash in front of your all-consuming fire. And the gift that night, because we always give a gift, was the ash from the oil drum. Not saying that our words are meaningless, but just reminding us. So, wow, before God, we are always blown apart. Right, I'm coming to the end. That's okay. Oh, right, oh, this is very important. I've got 5 minutes, haven't I? Yeah. It's good. And our sermons and our churches should be disruptive, provocative, subversive, and grounded. There's a great anecdote I love, which is where this Jewish community were seeking refuge from persecution. So they went to Vatican City, and Vatican City welcomed them in. But after the days turned into months and the months turned into years, eventually they went, "Oh, they're outstaying their welcome." And some of the priests went to the Pope and said, "We've really got to get rid of these guys, you know? It is Vatican City, after all." So the Pope doesn't want to just chuck them out. So the Pope says, "Well, I'll tell you what. I'll have a debate with the chief rabbi, and if I win the debate, they have to leave, and if they win the debate, they can stay." The priests think this is a great idea. The Jewish community accepts. Problem is, there's a language difference, and they don't want to use interpreters because so much can be missed. So they use the traditional language of sign, and they go out, And the little rabbi guy goes into this majestic cathedral, and the Pope's sitting on this great golden chair, you know, and they start, and the Pope begins. He holds up three fingers like this. And immediately the rabbi, as if, you know, knowing in advance what he would say, held up one finger like this. And the Pope suddenly is taken aback. And then the Pope goes like this. And immediately again, the rabbi, without thinking, just points to the ground. And finally, the Pope's definitely visibly disturbed, goes up and takes a chalice of red wine and this beautiful jewel-encrusted plate with the bread, with the wafers, comes up and shows them to the rabbi. And the rabbi, as if like prophetically knowing what was going to happen, reached into a brown crumpled paper bag that he'd brought in and held an apple in front of the Pope. And then they left, right? So the priests get round the Pope and go, "What happened? What happened?" And the Pope says, "Well, he won fair and square. Guy had an answer for everything. I said God is Trinity. And my rabbi friend reminded, but God is also one. God is one among three, right? And he said, and then I said, God is transcendent, above us, ruling down and looking down. And he says, my rabbi friend reminded me, God is in the dirt and soil of the earth, is in my neighbor, is with us right here, right now. And then I brought the bread and the wine, the body and blood of Christ, the second Adam, and my rabbi friend reminded me of the first Adam." So then some of the Jewish community go around the rabbi and say, "What happened? What happened?" The rabbi goes, "I can't believe it. I can't believe it." He says, "First of all, you've got 3 days to leave." He says, "What?" "Yeah," he says, "I said not one of us is going." What happened next? He says, "Well, I'm going to round you all up." He goes, "Well, you can try." He said, "We're staying rooted to the spot." And he says, "And what happened next?" He said, "That was the most frustrating thing." He says, "Then we broke for lunch." Right? So, the idea being, you know, the people, this is a standard tension between Judaism and Christianity. Judaism is very grounded, Christianity is very theological. But the truth is, Christianity, as Judeo-Christian, is both grounded and also descriptive. Like, it talks about God, but always in the service of the here and now. This tension is within Christianity itself. My friend wrote a parable. This is his parable that he wrote as he left church. This is his exit parable. He said, I dreamt that I died. And I went to heaven, and St. Peter was there opened the gates to welcome me in. "Oh, Phil, great to see you." And he said, "I was just about to step into heaven, and then I noticed some of my friends were there. Some of them atheists, some of them Buddhists, some of them God knows what," he says. And he said, "Peter, well, what about my friends?" And Peter says, "Well, you know the rules. You know the rules." And then Phil says, and then I thought of my reference point, Jesus the outsider, Jesus, the drunkard, the bastard, the friend of sinners. Jesus, the one who would always stay with those who were oppressed. And he said, "You know what? I'll just stay out here with them." And the parable ends with St. Peter breaking a smile, going, at last you understand. Right? That God so loved the world that he forsook heaven. You know, that's why Mother Teresa says, "If I am ever to become a saint, I shall be a saint of darkness, for I shall not be found in heaven, I shall be found outside as a light guiding the way." Last time I was in Grand Rapids, I was speaking at Calvin College, and after it was a 5-hour session, a debate, and near the end somebody said to me, he said, "You know, Pete, all this theology, you know, you don't say much about this resurrection. Do you deny the resurrection?" I says, "Do you deny the resurrection?" I went, "Okay, this is time to fess up. Yes, I do. Of course I do. Everyone who knows me knows I deny the resurrection. I do deny the resurrection. Every time I do not serve my neighbor, every time I walk away from people who are poor, I deny the resurrection. Every time I participate in an unjust system. And I affirm the resurrection every now and again. When I stand up for those who are on their knees, I affirm the resurrection. When I cry out for those people who have had their tongues torn out, when I weep for those people who have no more tears to shed." That is what we are trying to do. Substantive change. Thank you.